Bible study starting this Tuesday, January 24th, from 6 to 8 p.m. and running through March 23rd, with the exception of February 28th. The study is called An Introduction to the Theology of the Body, Discovering the Master Plan for Your Life. It is an 8-part, 4-hour study designed to give you a solid understanding of God's plan for humanity. This will take place at Our Lady's Hall at St. Joseph's. This weekend, we will take up the collection for the Church in Latin America. For many in Latin America and the Caribbean, a rising secular culture, difficult rural terrain, and a shortage of ministers all present obstacles to practicing the faith. Your support for the collection provides lay leadership training, catechesis, priestly and religious formation, and other programs to share our Catholic faith with those who long to hear the good news of Christ. The Collaborative invites you to a prayer and life workshop that will start at St. Joseph's Church on February 2nd. You will learn different ways of praying to have a deeper relationship with our Lord. You will also learn how to make prayer a part of your daily life with Jesus in your heart. Don't miss this unique opportunity. For more information, please check out the bulletin. At this Mass, we remember in a special way John Heath. Please stand and greet our celebrant, Father Antonio, and please join in singing our opening hymn, number 549 in your Breaking Bread issue, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 549.
Good evening, people of God. Welcome, welcome all of you today to the house of our Father, to our Holy Mass. The intention was already announced, but I would like to invite you. Let us place in the hands of God our personal intentions also. What you would like to pray for in this Holy Mass? Let us place in the hands of God. And having done that, let us start. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Knowing about the mercy of our God, let us ask for the forgiveness of our sins. Let us do it singing. I will do the first part, you repeat equal. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to the everlasting life. Amen. And now it's happiness. Let us sing glory to God in the highest.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord. Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Take a seat now and let us listen to the word of God.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. First, the Lord degraded the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the end, he has glorified the seaward road, the land west of the Jordan, the district of the Gentiles. Anguish has taken wing, dispelled is darkness, for there is no gloom where but now there was distress. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwelt in the land of gloom, a light has shone. You have brought them abundant joy and great rejoicing, as they rejoice before you as at the harvest, as people making merry when dividing spoils. For the yoke that burdened them, the pole on their shoulder, and the rod of their taskmaster you have smashed, as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my light.
that I may gaze on the loveliness of the Lord and contemplate his temple. The Lord is my light and my salvation. I believe that I shall see the bounty of the Lord in the land of the living. For the Lord with courage, be stout-hearted and wait for the Lord. The Lord is my light and my
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. For it has been reported to me about you, my brothers and sisters, by Chloe's people, that there are rivalries among you. I mean that each of you is saying, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with the wisdom of human eloquence, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its meaning. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. People of God, the Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. That what had been said through Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen. From that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He was walking by the Sea of Galilee and saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, casting a net into the sea. They were fishermen. He said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once, they left their nets and followed him. He walked along from there and saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. He called them, and immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. He went around all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness among the people. The gospel of the Lord. You can take a seat now. The first reading brings to us a message of hope from the prophet Isaiah, but I would like to put you in the context. What was that? What was going on there? Let me go back here. That time, the prophet Isaiah, when he was making this beautiful message, it sounds kind of strange, but the people of God, the 12 tribes, they had some tribes more in the north, two tribes, Zebulun and Naphtali, that is said there. And that region was a region like, where who would be the way for different countries, and then almost everybody would pass through there. And then when there was a war, guess what would happen to them? When they had good, hard times, they would be in trouble. And they were very far from Jerusalem. And then there were one of the 12 tribes to ask for help to Jerusalem until they would organize everything to go there. Too late, baby. Then they were in that situation, very complicated. And after some time, they really separated from the authority of Jerusalem to try to organize their own defense. Didn't work. I think the thing got even worse. But they still were, the two tribes were still part of the people of God. And God was attentive to the reality. And just for it, the message we see here in the gospel, it's a message of hope, showing the hardness what they were going through, but at the same time, it would not be like there that forever. And then, we can see the association with the first reading in the gospel when Jesus goes to that region. And then, they can make that association. Oh, Jesus was the light mentioned by the prophet who would give hope to the people of that region. But remember, it is kind of centuries later. But even to the people at that time, who was going through that hard time, good news came, and they could have a better way of life. But now, we see Jesus moving to that region after coming to know that his cousin, John the Baptist, the one who was preparing the people of God to be ready to the moment when the Messiah, Jesus, would come. Jesus came to know that he was put in jail. And then he moved to that region. And something interesting happens. He starts preaching, he starts his ministry exactly from where John stopped. Remember, John was preaching, announcing to the people, inviting them to change their life, conversion, penance, and he was preaching, convert, repent, because the kingdom of God is at hand. Look what the gospel says to us here. When Jesus moved to that region, the gospel says, from that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Something different from John? Mm-mm. It is like he took from where John left, where John stopped, he took exactly from there and kept carrying that good news. And it was not something that was prepared or started by John. It was coming since the Old Testament, from the time of Abraham, when God himself decided, because of the faith of Abraham. Can you imagine? God asked to him, do you know, I would like you offering your only son in holocaust, in sacrifice to me. Certainly he was like, what? But then he thought, okay, if God is asking for that, that's the right thing to do. And he would do that. He would. But God sent the angel to stop him. And because of that demonstration of trust in God, because of his faith, God, at that time, millennials before Jesus, said, because you showed this, of course, not with these same words, but because of your trust in me, from you, I will make a nation. And in this nation, your descendants, all the nations are going to be blessed. And then there started this idea of a people of God, started in Abraham. From his descendants, God formed a people. This people was the one supposed to give support to Jesus when he would come. And just for it, he chose 12 apostles to prepare the 12 tribes, the people of God, to spread the good news through all the other nations. And then we see the continuation of the project of God since Abraham until here with Jesus. And when he started preaching exactly what John was preaching, inviting the people to change their life, to convert, to repent, and something else. He was preaching to them about the kingdom of God. I like the expression the gospel says here. He went around of all the Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel, this word is interesting, of the kingdom of God. The gospel is the good news of the kingdom of God that is for everybody, not just for some. He was healing the people and curing every disease, bringing hope, bringing a new relationship of the people with God. He was building, bringing more, making it bigger from where John stopped. He was building the top of that. But it is important to us to listen to that and to see he called some guys to follow him. It's a very vocational gospel. His first disciples, in the gospel of today, we could hear they being called to be part of this project, and they said yes. But even today, he is calling each one of us for a different way of participation in his project of love. Each one of us, with our lives, with our families, with our professions, what you do to live, for living. Each one of us, we are also called by God to give support, to be part of his project of love, with the tools, with our abilities and talents we have, we receive it from him. And then, if you are a doctor, a lawyer, a constructor, or astronaut, a teacher, whatever, there you can make some difference. We can give continuation to this project of love of God. When we look at the second reading, still very close there to the time of Jesus, we see St. Paul. I can't deny to you when I read the reading, I had some little laugh because it was interesting to see something here, and I underlined it to share with you. St. Paul writes to the Corinthians questioning that attitude of them of creating so many divisions among them according with the ideas of the leader they had. And then some people are saying, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, I belong to Cephas, I belong to Christ. And then he questions that. What is wrong with you guys? We all are preaching the good news of Jesus. We all are one people, one church. We are the church. Unity. No division. And then when he brings these questions to the people of that community, he's trying to show to them that it is important to us know the difference that exist in the community and to work together because we complement what the other can't do. Each one of us. I can't do everything alone. I need you with your abilities, with your talents to build together the kingdom of God here. We are important for what we are, for what we have. And God counts on us. I was saying I got some love here because I was reading this letter of St. Paul, and he says, my brothers and sisters, by Chloe's people, I came to know that there are rivalries among you. And then I was thinking, oh my God. If that letter was read in the community and the Chloe's people were there, I imagine the rest of the community looking to them like, you know, but they were denouncing a situation that was breaking the community of the Corinthians. And Paul tried to fix that, showing that doesn't matter what movement in the church we participate, what liturgical group, what part of the church we sit, we are the church of Jesus Christ. The one which has for characteristic the identity of unity. He calls us for unity, for integration, and to together complement each other and to make the difference in the world around us. And then we are important to give continuation to the project of God in our time, in our generation, as Jesus took from John, who was bringing already from the Old Testament. The disciples gave continuation, the apostles, and today it is there for us. We are the ones called by God to give continuation to the project of God in our life, in our time, in our generation of the people of God. Usually in the weekends, we don't celebrate so many the saints as we do during the week. And I always like to say, some days in the calendar of the church, we have a lot of saints that we celebrate, but some days we don't have saints some days. And I like always to say, do you know, when we don't have a saint in the calendar of the church, it means that day, I like to say, we don't have a saint yet. Because for that day, the next saint can be you. Yeah, think about that. There is a lot of dates in the liturgical calendar of our church that where we don't celebrate any saints. It means it is still possible. It is always possible. That space is opened to you, to me, to us. And then Let us live our faith with intensity, with integrity, and even if the church never canonizes us, I can assure you there is a lot of saints from the beginning of the Christianity until today that never were canonized, but before God, yes, they are great. They are saints. And we are invited also to, in our times, to be the saints our generation needs. Amen? Let us stand now and profess our faith together, saying, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things, visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For as men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And the Holy Spirit, incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became a man. For our sake he was crucified on the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, let us present to the Lord our prayers, our needs, our intentions, our thankfulness. He always listens to us.
That the church continue to reveal the merciful face of God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those in authority treat citizens and employees justly and be mindful of their dignity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people who are still struggling for their independence should soon achieve it without bloodshed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all would come to believe in the sacredness of human life from conception to natural death, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who gather here will be nourished by this banquet of love, mindful that Christ is calling us to holiness and love, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for John Heath, for whom today's Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. For all the personal intentions we have in our hearts. We pray to the Lord for peace in the holy world, for the end of war, violence, corruption, injustice. We pray to the Lord. And let us show our thankfulness to our God for so many good things he does for us, saying together, thank you, Father. Almighty Father, listen to our prayers and attend the eyes if it is your will. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. You can take a seat now. This is the moment of the offertory. Take this first.
Our offertory hymn is number 449 in your Breaking Bread issue. Amazing Grace, number 449. Amen. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did the Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that your sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It's truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation, through Christ our Lord. Through him, the hosts of angels adore your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." People of God, behold the mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that we have held your eyes worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, and all the clerics. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Among them today we pray for John Hilt. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us, all we pray, that which the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her blessed spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and the honor is yours, forever and ever. Of God, let us pray like Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Lord, look not on our sins, but on the faith of our church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Then with a beautiful smile. Yeah, this one is perfect. With this beautiful smile, let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace with you. Peace with you. People of God, behold the Lamb of God. Behold Him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us to the everlasting life. Amen. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Our communion hymn is number 608 in your Breaking Bread issue. Your words are spirit and life, number 608. Everlasting.
Let us pray. Grant we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us the new life, we may always glory in your gift. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. By the intercession of the holy spouses Mary and Joseph, may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to serve the Lord. Just a little thing. Yeah. January 23 is the Feast of the Holy Spouses. You know that I have a beautiful devotion. I like them. Just for it, Holy Spouse, Mary and Joseph. I always bless the community through their intercession. Monday is their feast. And then, with your permission, I would like to give a special bless for the spouses here present today. And the ones who are here, but the other don't. Almighty Father, by the intercession of Mary and Joseph, bless all the spouses who are here. Bless our parents. Bless all the ones who look to live a life with the integrity of your family as you planned. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. With happiness, go in peace to serve the Lord. And have a great week and a blessed week.
Our closing hymn is number 412 in your Breaking Bread issue, Christ Before Us, number 412.
Savior.